So what you guys are here now looking at, I'm pretty sure that you'll be able to recognize this particular bell, possibly because of the color and in the title of the video. This is a Western Railroad Supply 1206F gong bell. And now, this is something that's really truly historical to me. And this is the rarest, if not the rarest, Chicago and Northwestern Railroad historic relic. This particular gong bell had came off an F unit from the Chicago Northwestern in commuter service. And this particular one, I got this from a collector in Wisconsin, and I saw this in his collection. It was actually piled up in a lot of his other relics that he had, and I thought it was one of the coolest things that he had owned, because these things are just so rare that I didn't even know that you could even find these now. Personally, I have researched this bell, and there's very little information about this bell, not even photos of him in private collections. The guy that I met, he's the only one that I have met who actually owns one of these things. And a lot of people also would remember the Chicago Northwestern commuter set at the Illinois Railway Museum with 411, which is a restored F unit at the Illinois Railway Museum. And this particular one, specifically, he told me that it either came off of an F unit or a Crandall cab. And in case if you don't know what a Crandall cab is, a Crandall cab is a rebuilt E unit, which was an EB unit, a B unit, and it just had a cab placed on it. And the Chicago Northwestern only just had a handful of those units built, but none of them survived. By the time that Chicago Northwestern retired them, they were all scrapped. This gong bell was probably made sometime in the late 70s, after when I had somebody who was a Chicago Northwestern employee appraised this bell. He checked it over, he looked at everything, I gave him descriptions, I sent him pictures, and he determined that this bell was made sometime in the late 70s, before Western Railroad Supply became Western Coal and Hayes in 1979. So, after when I saw this gong bell in this guy's collection, and this goes way back to Labor Day of this year, I then had some thoughts about it after when I remembered it, and then another month later, I then called the guy, and then I asked him if he was interested in selling his gong bell. And he says that he was very happy to sell it to me because he said he would really appreciate it if it got sold off to somebody who would appreciate this stuff as much as he did. And I got really excited, and then he gave me a really great offer on this bell. So then I then picked it up at Train Fest in Milwaukee. He brought this bell from home, and then he brought it to me, and then I met up with him after the show, picked it up, and then took it home with me. And the bell was in really great shape, and I started taking the bell apart, but then I had some concerns, and my parents said they had some concerns about it because the railroad would commonly use lead paint on their railroad stuff, like parts and bells, horns, stuff like that. And later on in a video, I'll probably talk to you and make a video on easy tips and safety tips on restoring railroad equipment. But that would be a later video I would probably talk about another time. But let's continue and focus on this bell. So I had some people examine it and determine that the paint that was on it did not have lead paint on it, but still safety precautions that some stuff would have lead paint on it. But so then I took it to my college class, and my teacher happily was a railroad guy himself, so he let me work on this bell in class. I put it in the sandblaster, which had a powder aluminum oxide blasting out of it, so clearly when I was starting to take the paint off of the bell, I have noticed that the gray paint that was originally on this bell, I thought that it was the original paint that was on it before, but before I started taking this bell apart when I first got it, I started to notice that in this portion of where the bolts go, I saw some yellow paint showing through, so that really did determine that this came from Chicago and Northwestern because it was CNW yellow. And I started blasting the paint off of the bell, and then the original yellow paint was painted over from the gray paint, so that really showed that this was true CNW heritage, and I got really excited. So then I started continuing to take this bell apart, and then it took me 3 days to powder blast all the old paint off of the gong bell. And I then started looking around for the paint, and Rust-Oleum happily has almost an exact matching yellow, which I was really happy that they did have a matching color for Chicago and Northwestern yellow. And it took me throughout November just to finish this bell, and then it became another challenge that I had. So the problem that I had with the getting the bell to run properly was the power supply that I needed for the gong bell. And a lot of people who are Chicago Northwestern fans, the biggest question that they always ask is, how does the gong bell work? And I'd be happy to explain. This is the motor power supply that is used for powering the bell. And this is a Western Railroad Supply Booney DC motor. And Booney is a motor manufacturer that was in Chicago. Not sure exactly what year their company was founded and everything, but we're mainly focusing on the gong bell. So on the motor, there's this small gear that connects to this gear. And then there's a smaller gear that's here that goes to the main gear. And the main gear has this special part that's on here that you can see here. It extends out towards almost the middle diameter of the gear, and it goes to the hammer clapper that's here. And the hammer clapper, when this rotates, it will lift up this bell, the hammer, and you could see this part on here that will rub against this when it's going up and down, creating the noise. And that's how a Chicago Northwestern gong bell works when it's going in a rotating motion. So it just keeps going, and it won't create the noise. And gong bells are not normally common on locomotives today, but the Chicago South Shore and South Bend uses it on their electric cars in commuter service. But a lot of Chicago Northwestern fans remember these on F units and E units, which were the Crandall cabs, which, like I explained before. And another thing, these lines that are right here, these are oil lines, and there's these little hatches that are on the top of the bell behind the rain shield that are the lubricating lines that go to these specially custom rods that go into here that were specially designed for this bell for lubricating purposes. And the oil goes through these brass fittings that go into the hole, and there's these little holes that are inside of the rod that will connect to in here, and it will lubricate the rods inside the bell. So anyway, my main purpose of getting the bell to properly work is that it takes 74 volts, 0.4 amps, which says here on this stamp here on the motor, that's how much voltage is exactly what comes out of a locomotive power source that goes to the bell. That's how the bell got their power. But power supplies, they're pretty hard to find, and they're very expensive if you want to get that precise voltage. And those are like $500 to like $1,300, but I found a special way to do it, and that's by using 9 to 8 9-volt batteries. And I'll be happy to also explain that as well. So currently I have about 11 9-volt batteries out on here, and I know that may seem more than 74 volts because these are 9 volts each, but I have 11 on here, but most of these batteries have less voltage on there, which is around the appropriate range for 74 volt 0.4 amps. And I don't know a lot about this stuff that's on here, but it says here that the appropriate running speed for this bell is 1650 RPMs, which is on here, which seems fast, but it is the appropriate speed that you hear on the Chicago Northwestern gong bells. But I will give this bell a go so you guys can hear it, and it will appropriately be running at this appropriate speed. And I have all the power going through this fork switch. It's a GRS fork switch. And so I'll give this a quick demonstration of it running. So that's typically the appropriate running speed that you hear, and the classic sound that you'll hear from a Chicago Northwestern gong bell In a later video that I'll have, I'll probably just have a separate video of it going without this narration that I'm giving of the bell, but this is just for showing of what people can do. If you have gotten one of these bells and you need some help restoring this, this is one of those easy tips of what you can do. So here's an up-close view of the bell in operation, and like I showed you before, you'll see this piece spinning around and hitting and pushing up on the hammer, making a noise in a continuous cycle. So here on top of the bell, like I explained before, there's these little hatches that are on top of here, and like you pour your oil down here and then it will lubricate the lines that I showed, the oil lines that I showed you that go down to the bearings that are inside of the gong bell. And there are three of them on here, that's for each gear that's on there. And it's pretty cool because this bell has been very well taken care of and it's in really good condition and there's no wear on the motor. It looks like the motor is brand new as well. I mean, literally when I opened this bell up for the first time before I started working on it, it was in really, really perfect condition. It's like that it was just made in the 70s, and to be honest with you, F units were used on the Chicago Northwestern and commuter service in Chicago until 1983, and then they were replaced by RTA, currently now Metra's, F40PH's, and the gong bells started to continue to be used on the bi-level cars that were painted white and brown and orange, and then they faded into the chrome fluted coaches like what we see today. So the way that these were painted, in my opinion, and the way that I have it here, is that the front of them would be painted yellow, and the back portion that was hidden behind the nose of the F units or the crandle cabs, they would be like a gray or like a darkish cream color is what the original back color was before, but I decided to go with gray. And my favorite part of the bell is here on the back. It says Western Railroad Supply Chicago, and the back door is just held in by three nuts. The third one's hidden underneath the big back end on here as well. And Western Railroad Supply did make railroad crossing bells with this same style setup, but those are even rarer than this. But still, in my opinion, that this is one of the rarest Chicago Northwestern relics that are really hard to find today. And to me, it even caught me off by surprising me that these can actually still exist if you know where to look. But still, these are very rare to find, and I'm very happy that I got this in my collection and got it working. It just blows me away. This is still one of the rarest things that I have in my collection right now, and it's Chicago history and Chicago Northwestern history. And I'm just saying right now that you're not going to find one of these anytime soon, because during the time when the Chicago Northwestern retired these from service on their F units, and the RTA removed them from their old cab cars, they just like threw them away. There wasn't any way of saving these things. So I'm wanting to say that like these bells were like gone, junked. They just wanted to toss these things away. And I'm just thinking that there's not many of these things even in collections or kept in collections right now, but they could be used on other railroads. The California Northern, I do know that they use the gong bells on some of their diesels, but still, I'd like to wrap things up and say thanks for watching this video, and tune in for more videos, and as much appreciation, if you're a Chicago Northwestern fan and if you see this video, please leave a like. And if you have any questions about this gong bell, and if you want me to answer your questions about this gong bell, please leave a comment below. And always, and if you're considered watching more of my videos and tuning in for more videos coming to my YouTube channel, please subscribe for more videos. And I appreciate everything for all my subscribers for watching my videos and a lot of the positive comments that I get from you guys. So thanks for tuning in. Thanks for watching this video, and I'll see you next time.